Hey, looking for a car truck? Search the AutoChannel.com's actual price paid guide to quickly and easily find 100% accurate used car values. Don't get the blues, get smart, not screwed. The AutoChannel.com, there's nothing else like it.
USA presents a live internet news conference on the all-new MINI Convertible. Here is your host and moderator, MINI Communications Manager, Natalie Bouters.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning, and welcome to our MINI studio. We are broadcasting live, and I would like to extend a special welcome to our media guests who are joining us online this morning. Welcome. We're looking forward to receiving and answering your questions during the show, so please don't be shy. Today, I thought it would be good to have a chat about all things MINI with you, the media, joining us as our guests and participating in the discussion. Of course, today you will learn a lot about MINI in general, and there's some very topical things on MINI's mind and on your minds. But today, the highlight, ladies and gentlemen, is the all-new MINI Convertible, a car that offers the thrill of open-air motoring in a stylish yet fun-to-drive package. And that's what MINI is all about. But before we go into detail about the MINI Convertible, I would like to invite Jim McDowell, head of MINI USA, to join me for a chat about how things are going for us these days and what's to expect from MINI in the near future. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jim McDowell. Welcome, Jim.
Good morning, Natalie.
So Jim, let's start with 2008, a very good year for us. What were the highlights in your mind?
Well, in 2008, MINI sold more than 54,000 cars in the United States. And that was about 29% more than the year before. Our market share went up from about 11.1% to 15.6%. So you have to look at that as being really a good performance. Now, we believe very strongly in balancing supply and demand. We were able to do that because the factory was prepared to work with three shifts, which pretty much meant that they were working 23 hours a day, 7 days a week. With the challenging economic conditions in the world today, that third shift is no longer required. So the factory is going back to two shifts, but that will still leave plenty of cars for the US market.
And Jim, since 2002, we worked really hard to establish MINI as the premium small car brand in the US. How do you think we'll increase our footprint despite record low gas prices?
Well, you know, it's interesting. Let's look at 2008 as a package. In 2008, we had the beginning of a challenging economy. We had high gas prices. People had difficulty getting credit. And from that perspective, it created the perfect conditions for people to reconsider the choices that they've always been making in terms of a car. And that benefited MINI. Now, right now, with lower gas prices, there isn't quite the urgency that there was in the summer for people to make the shift. But we still have that fun, unique driving experience, customization, extremely high resale values that are drawing people to the brand. And I don't expect that these low gas prices will remain low very long.
You know, I recently read the headline, MINI is the new black. Do you think small is the future, Jim?
I think in a lot of people's minds, small and premium is highly correlated. Just looking around the room at electronics, I think we've known that for a long time, that premium electronics are the smallest electronics. It's interesting, about 2 years ago, supermarkets started getting smaller in the United States. I think we all decided it wasn't worth walking 20 minutes to go get our half gallon of milk to walk through that gigantic supermarket. And houses. Houses are getting smaller as well. So from that perspective, we see plenty of indications that we have a society that's increasingly considering small.
And I think we can certainly say, Jim, that this trend carries true in the car markets, because we see people trade in SUVs and pickup trucks for a Mini. Mm-hmm. What do you think are the main reasons people downsize these days?
Well, we think that there are four reasons that people might consider downsizing to have a more economical car. The first is pure economics. Some people can no longer afford their daily commute. They just live too far from their work. They're not getting sufficient gas mileage. So those people are economic oriented. Then there are people that I would say are efficiency oriented. And these are people that can afford to drive, but it just feel a little bit silly pulling into the gas station, requiring all that fuel. It's almost like you're the last person in the United States that has a dial-up computer as opposed to high-speed internet. And you want to get on to what's the next more modern thing. The third group are people that I think are making the shift for altruistic reasons. And they know that we have finite natural resources and that they want to be able to leave some resources for their children and their children's children. And the fourth group, I would say, are people that are independence-oriented. They're aware that a lot of our oil comes from outside the United States. They want to do their part to minimize the amount of wealth that we transfer to other countries.
And this leads me to talk a little bit about the Mini buyer, Jim. Our buyer is defined by a certain mindset rather than conventional demographics. Mm-hmm. Do you think the need for more practicality today has changed the Mini buyer?
Well, the core Mini buyer is a performance enthusiast. They're the people that have many exciting cars in their garage. The Mini is the one that they use as a daily driver. They're not afraid to take out in any kind of weather. They don't worry if it gets a ding because it's a mark of honor on the car. The second group are the people that we call our design-oriented statement makers. And they're the people that look at their Mini as a canvas. It's an extension of them. They're very interested in all the UFification and customization programs that we have. It's as personal to them as their house is personal to them. The third group are people that we call our social connectors. They're the heart of the Mini community. They're people that love going out and having new experiences, meeting other Mini drivers, and they really enjoy carrying that message on to all their friends and family and anyone that will listen to them because they're so enthusiastic. And then the fourth group are people that have bought their car for very emotional reasons, but they're very much aware of the practical reasons why it was a great car to buy. So they'll tell you about how wonderful their drive was that morning, and then they'll very readily tell you what their miles per gallon was, how environmentally conscious the car was, how great the resale value would be, but of course they don't want to sell the car, how great the car would be in a crash because of its safety ratings. And that last group has been growing in importance, I would say, a little bit over the last year.
Don't you think it's interesting to see how design savvy these people are and how they really want to stand out from the crowd? You mentioned customization, UFification as we call it. Let's talk about a few examples here, Jim.
Well, the most important thing to remember is that a base Mini is a car where you still have a lot of choices. And from that perspective, my base Mini wouldn't look necessarily like your base Mini because we make them uniquely our own. But there's so much more that you can do in the Mini program, and our drivers are really willing to reach a little deeper into their pocket. So from that perspective, the typical Mini has $4,000 to $5,000 worth of options and accessories on it at the time that it is delivered. And these options and accessories are really important to people in terms of making their Mini their own. And for example, it might surprise you that about half of the Minis sold are sold with leather. Because from that perspective, that's something that is very important to people to create the custom interior that they desire. And some features come out of nowhere to being very popular. So one of them that's really been ascending in popularity is one that is the Bluetooth prep that enables you to connect your iPod and has a USB port.
Let's talk a little bit about our dealer network, Jim. We currently have 83 dealers, but this is going to change in the future, isn't it? Can you share some of our expansion plans?
Sure, our network is changing in two ways. Of the 83 existing dealers, 50% of them are currently involved in construction projects. They want to increase their facility, make it nicer, so that they're prepared for Mini's expanded lineup. And then additionally, we're adding 13 additional dealers, and they'll be opening over the next 13 months.
That's wonderful news, Jim, and will certainly help us increase our footprint and grow the brand in the future here in the U.S. Now let's talk about what we're really here for, the new Mini Convertible. Mm-hmm. First generation, 2004. Since then, how many Mini Convertibles on the road in the U.S. these days?
Okay, so far we have sold 39,000 Mini Convertibles in the United States. Virtually all of those are still on the road. And that represents about a quarter of the Mini Convertibles that have been sold throughout the world.
The U.S. is an important market, isn't it?
Let there be no question. The U.S. is a very important market, the most important market for the convertible, and also for the Mini brand as a whole.
And I think we plan to keep it this way.
We're working on that, very much so.
Now, Mini is a British brand and it's being produced in the UK. Is this also going to be the case for the Mini Convertible, Jim?
All Minis are produced in what we call the production triangle. And the pressings are done in Swindon in England. And then the motors come from nearby Hams Hall. And then they all come together in Oxford, England, where that's where the body's assembled, the vehicle's painted, and the final assembly occurs.
So in general, Jim, what are your expectations for the Mini Convertible?
Well, my expectations for the Mini Convertible are, one, I think it'll be a fun and exciting lineup. We'll have a Cooper and a Cooper S starting the 28th of March. Then we'll be adding the John Cooper Works in April production. So we'll have a full lineup of exciting Minis that people can drive. I think the second generation will do better than the first generation in terms of sales, primarily because there are so many features and technologies available on the new Mini Convertible than the first generation. I think everyone will just look at it as a much better Mini Convertible.
Excellent. And let's talk a little bit about those enhancements and new features in the Mini Convertible. And I know just the person who can do this for us. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Vincent Kung, Mini Product Manager. Welcome, Vinny.
Thank you.
I can call you Vinny, right?
Yes, Vinny, I prefer it.
So Vinny, to talk about these features, obviously you need a car. We don't have a car here, but you and I spent some time with the vehicle yesterday. Let's take a look. We already know what we can expect from the Mini Convertible in general, but Mini wouldn't be Mini without going into the details. So let's go into detail now with Product Manager Vincent Kung and talk about what the differences are between the previous model and the current one.
Well, thank you very much, Natalie. Yes, the 2009 Mini Convertible is completely new. If you notice here, the first thing you'll see is the wheel. And this is the unique 17-inch Blackstar bullet wheel, which is only available on the Cooper S convertibles. Now, the other thing to note is that the Cooper convertible now starts off with a 16-inch wheel with a run-flat tire, whereas the previous generation convertible had a 15-inch wheel that was not a run-flat. Now, going to the side over here, you can see the more pronounced body line, which is not only different in shape, but also taller, giving the Mini Convertible new style all its own. This active rollover protection bar is also new for 2009. It replaces the previous generation's fixed protection bar, offering the driver more rearward visibility. Of course, this does not compromise safety one bit. Should the vehicle get into a situation where a rollover can occur, the active rollover protection bar will deploy immediately within a blink of an eye.
This is a convertible vehicle after all, so let's close the top and see how long it takes to close this roll.
Sure.
Why don't you tell me how long it's supposed to take?
Going up, it's as quick as it going down, which takes only 15 seconds.
15 seconds. So Vinny, I think we all agree that the car is cool, stylish, fun to drive. But is it also practical?
Absolutely. Let's start off with the split folding rear seats. They're standard on every Mini Convertible.
Okay.
Simply push the button up top here, and you can fold the seat right down. Could you help me out?
Sure.
Thanks. So now you can see the interior has full access to the rear cargo area. And what's cool about this is now that you can load in things that you normally never thought you could load into a convertible.
We have a very nice clean surface here on the outside. Didn't the previous generation have two hinges on the outside? What's changed here?
Well, you're right. The 2009 Mini Cooper convertible and Cooper S convertibles now have hinges on the inside, so they're no longer out here. The vehicle still opens downward like the previous generation car and does hold up to 176 pounds. And like the previous generation car, it has the easy load function. Let me show you. Simply reach in, pull the handles, lift the base of the convertible stack up, pull the parcel shelf out of the way, and you have a massive opening to put anything you want into the car, right?
Now that's practical.
Yes, it is.
The car is certainly very beautiful and stylish on the outside, but let's talk about the inside and what are the differences here?
Sure, well, this is all new 2009 Mini Convertible, has the all new interior seen on the other Minis in the family. Like all the other cars, it has many iconic design elements that, as you can see here, are circular. This particular car has the interior surface in the body color, which is interchange yellow. Mm-hmm. The speedometer is in the middle, and the tachometer is on top of the steering column.
And what is this gauge to the left of the steering wheel there? It says hours and minutes. What is this?
That's actually the new odometer, which comes standard on all US-specific Mini convertibles. It actually counts down in hours and minutes, as you mentioned, with the top down and the engine running. And it also stores all that time into the body computer. So for the life of the vehicle, it'll know how long the top has been down.
So when you're in your garage, can you cheat?
No, there's no cheating. The odometer always knows. Top must be down and the engine must be running.
Excellent. Thank you, Vinny, for talking us through the car. Now, there's a couple points that I'm sure our audience will want to know about that we didn't touch on yet. Let's start with the roof. There's something else we didn't mention there.
Well, sure. A convertible wouldn't be a convertible if it didn't have a top that went down. But lucky for us, we still have a fully powered top with a sunroof function that carries over from the previous generation car. This allows the two front occupants to have an uninhibited view of the sky above. The top itself goes down in just 15 seconds. It's fully power, as I mentioned earlier, so there are no latches to operate, no handles and other things to turn. And it can be operated at speeds of up to 18 miles per hour.
And safety is very important these days, Vinny. There are some very important safety features that have been enhanced in the second generation convertible. Let's go into a little bit more detail here.
Well, sure. The Mini convertible is engineered to be safe from the start, but there are four key features I'd like to discuss here, including the reinforced A-pillar, reinforced rocker sills on the side, reinforced floor pan, and of course the active rollover protection part that I talked about before. Now what this does is deploys should the vehicle get into a rollover situation to protect all four occupants that are inside.
And as with every Mini, this car offers excellent power for the mile per gallon. And I know you like to say quicker, really quick, but let's share some figures.
Okay, sure. All three vans will be available soon, and there are the Cooper, the Cooper S, and the John Cooper Works version. So let's start off with the Cooper. It's powered by a naturally aspirated 1.6-liter four-cylinder, which produces 118 horsepower and 114 pound-feet of torque. Now this translates into a 0-60 time of 8.9 seconds, and the best part, it gets 36 miles per gallon on the highway with the standard 6-speed manual. With the optional 6-speed automatic, fuel economy is 34 miles per gallon. Still very impressive. Now moving up the performance ladder, we go to the Cooper S. And this gets a turbocharged version of the engine, which produces 172 horsepower and 177 pound-feet of torque. And with the overboost function, we get 192 pound-feet of torque available for extra passing power. Now, there's very little compromise here to fuel economy. So you can see, we get 34 miles per gallon on the highway with the manual transmission. Now, let's talk about the fiery John Cooper Works model. And this guy right here produces 208 horsepower, 192 pound-feet of torque, and with the overboost function, 207 pound-feet of torque. 0-60 time drops right here to 6.5 seconds now. As you may have noticed, fuel economy doesn't suffer one bit.
And Vinny, I've noticed also that the fuel efficiency, the fuel economy for the John Cooper Works model is the same as the Cooper S model. That's great value.
Right.
Now, what else can we mention about John Cooper Works that's special here?
Well, aside from the things that we know, such as the horsepower and the fuel economy that we've got, the John Cooper Works models have a lot of the features found on the Mini Challenge race cars, which are campaigned throughout Europe, New Zealand, and Australia. And that includes the 17-inch Challenge spoke alloy wheels, the Brembo brakes in front, which are 12.4 inches in diameter, and in back, 11.0 inches diameter, which are an upsize from the 10.2 inch rotors that are found on the Cooper S's. Other things that are noteworthy include dynamic traction control, which is an electronic stability control function that has a higher threshold before it intervenes, so you can tack your favorite back row and let the car get a little sideways before it tries to pull in on the front. It also features electronic differential lock control standard, which uses the front brake calipers to control the torque from left to the right wheel under heavy acceleration. Now, the engine itself has been upgraded in many ways to produce the extra power, and this includes revised pistons, compression ratio, back-cut intake valves within the cylinder head, and a revised turbocharger with a larger aspect ratio for more boost. We also get a beefed up clutch to handle the extra torque and a gearbox with revised bearings inside to handle extra power and get it to the ground.
Now let's confirm pricing for each of these models, Vinny.
Okay. At first, we're going to offer the Cooper and Cooper S, and they will both go on sale on March 28th. The Cooper will start at $24,550, and the Cooper S, $27,450. The John Cooper Works models will come online in April once they start production at that time, and will go on sale at $34,950. Now, important thing to note here is that all these prices include the $650 destination and handling charge.
That's excellent. Now, let's talk about these different packages. You know, I can't wait to drive one. Will you help me spec out my next company car?
Yeah.
What should I be looking out for?
Sure. Well, all Minis have four key packages, and that includes premium package, convenience package, sport package, and cold weather package. So just to go over each one real briefly, the first one is premium package, and priced at $1,250. It includes items such as the chrome line interior and exterior for some style and automatic air conditioning for some function. Moving up to convenience package, we incorporate some very popular items such as the comfort access, which is the keyless go, and the Bluetooth and USB iPod adapter, which as Jim had mentioned before, has been growing in popularity. That's why we incorporate it on the 09 models, including the new convertible. Sport package is available only on the Cooper and Cooper S's because a lot of the contents in here are already standard on the John Cooper Works models, such as the upsized 17-inch wheels. And lastly is cold weather package, which is very popular for those that live in colder climates, which naturally gives you, just for $500, heated front seats, heated washer jets, and power folding mirrors.
Great stuff, Vinny. Thank you so much.
Yeah, sure.
Now let's take a short commercial break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back, right after this. Welcome back. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we saved the best for last. Please welcome MINI Marketing Manager, Trudy Hardy. Welcome, Trudy.
Good morning.
Thanks for joining us. Now, Trudy, let's delve right in. The ads we just saw refer to our communications claim, always open. Tell us more.
Well, always open was the communication claim that we used to launch the convertible back in 2004. And for us, it's much more than a communication claim. It's a set of values. I mean, we talked about always motoring with the top down, so how it relates to the way we drive the vehicle. But it's also more than that. It's also a consumer mindset. And our customers are very, very open to new experiences and new opportunities.
And we took this a step further with the MINI Convertible, didn't we, Trudy?
We did. And it's really neat to see that the designers and the engineers in Munich, that this communication philosophy really resonated with them, that they actually developed a mechanism to track the openness in the vehicle. So it's really neat to see a marketing claim kind of reverse engineer itself in the product.
Now, Trudy, MINI is a fun and quirky brand and also always has some interesting marketing ideas. What do we have up our sleeve for MINI Convertible?
Well, I think we should start with the openometer because, you know, it's distinctive, it's unique to the car. What can we do with the openometer? We've got this great mechanism that tracks how open you are, but we also have this great community of MINI drivers. And we want to find a way to actually bring the consumer together with the openometer and encourage them to really be open. So what we're going to do is create a microsite for our new MINI convertible owners It's like a social networking site, like a Facebook or a MySpace, where we can actually encourage them to upload their open times to the website and really encourage people to be more open. So just a friendly competition amongst our new owner base, but they can upload their pictures, and what you see here on the mock-up of the homepage is those that have motored upward of 1,000 hours, all the way down to those that have motored for 10 hours open. And it's a really nice way that we can call out a monthly winner who was the most open for the month of June. We can rank our most open motorers, the top 10, and we have a cumulative open tally, so we can see motorers across the world how open we are as a brand. If you want to learn more about one of these participants, you can click on one of the images, and up will come a little profile of Superfly. You can see that he's 92 hours open, he's currently in 50th position, and he can upload photos to the photo gallery, and this also shows a history of when he's uploaded his open times. So uploading the open times, we'll talk about that for 1 second. Very, very easy. You can just take a digital picture and you can upload it through the site. But we're also working with iPhone and the new Google phone and BlackBerry to actually take a picture from the car, and it will upload automatically using some digital recognition software. So we're working with them to make it an easier process to upload your open times. And then ultimately, what we'd like to see is, you know, just to be able to look at the U.S., and you'll see that these colors are represented in our new interchange yellow and the new blue, and you can see our top 25 most open motorers. And we're really excited because the markets from around the world also want to participate in this. So ultimately, these little dots are represented by our new MINI convertible drivers. So it should be a really fun way to encourage people to be more open.
Absolutely. And I love this idea for the community. But will we also reach out to target customers, to prospects out there in a different way?
Of course. I mean, this is a nice way to engage the community, but we know that we need to reach new prospects. So our broad-reaching mediums for the new convertible will be print, out-of-home, and interactive.
Let's talk about print first.
Sure. For print, we, MINI always loves engaging inserts. So with some high-profile magazines like Entertainment Weekly, Vanity Fair, Rolling Stone, Spin, we'll be doing an inside gatefold. And I have an example. We'll just show you Men's Journal. If you open up the front cover of Men's Journal, you'll see an ad for the new MINI convertible, but it actually has a flip-up gatefold. So when you open up the front cover and it flips up, you will reveal the unlimited headroom with the new MINI convertible.
That's great. Will this also be used somewhere else?
It will. We're actually buying some outdoor spectaculars in New York, in Miami, in Chicago, on large building sides that really capture high traffic area, high foot traffic, and really have pay a lot of attention to the convertible. I'll show you a close-up. There we go. So in those three markets, we'll be taking over building sides. And then for our top five markets, which would also include Los Angeles and San Francisco, we'll be running an extensive out-of-home campaign. And you can see we've put these little extensions on the top of the billboard, and it just really helps bring the convertible to life. It helps pop, off of off the billboard, bring some attention. We'll use the unlimited headroom execution. And one of my favorites, Open Sesame. And then a couple headlines that just speak to open-mindedness. So what doesn't close you makes you stronger. And lastly, throw caution to the wind, literally.
Looks great. Now, knowing how important the web is these days, typically we've been doing some very cool online things as well, and different things. Mm-hmm. What do you have planned there?
Personally, I love digital communication. A lot of people are doing research online now. I mean, they do more research online before they actually go into a dealership. So it's a really important medium. It also helps you bring the car to life. It allows you to have the car appear very, very dynamically in interactive flash modules. So I brought a couple with me today. And the first one is a cooperation with weather.com. And this will allow you to enter in your zip code wherever you are and find out what your local motoring conditions are. So this is just a mock-up, but we'll enter in Sausalito, and it's 48 degrees and partly cloudy in Sausalito. So really neat way to get users to engage, and it actually makes it relevant for them, so they actually get some useful information as well. The second one is a widget that will also allow you to just see what your car looks like on the beach, maybe with some wildlife, or maybe you can spin that dial around and go to the mountains with a co-pilot, or maybe you can see what it looks like in the city and it's raining and there's some fireworks. So just, you know, I mean, the ultimate goal is to get people to engage with these banners. And the third one that I brought through is just a self-playing banner. So it plays off of the unlimited headroom. It just self-plays, revealing the headline, and ultimately always comes back to a drive to miniusa.com. It's our most powerful metric. If we can get people to click through to the site and configure a car, if they send that lead to a dealer, 1 in 3 people end up buying a car. So it's a really powerful medium for us.
Fantastic. Now, Trudy, I know personally about some very interesting things we have planned for the rest of this year. Do you mind sharing with our audience what we have planned in terms of marketing activities for the rest of this year?
Yeah, it is definitely, we're dealing with some economic challenges in 2009, but MINI really is an instigator of optimism. And I think you're going to see creativity that really speaks to that open-mindedness and that optimistic spirit in the rest of 2009. We've talked about value, we've talked about great product substance, and when you combine that with uniqueness and premium features, it really puts us in a good place for 2009.
That's right. And Trudy, one final question before we move on. Don't we have a birthday coming up?
You and I actually have a big milestone.
But we don't want to talk about
year.
That.
We're turning 39 again, I think. But I think what you're referring to is MINI's 50th birthday celebration.
That's right.
And what we're going to do this year is we bring the global owner community together every other year. So we're really thrilled that this year in 2009, we'll be bringing everyone back to MINI's birthplace, to the United Kingdom, going to Silverstone. And we're looking for upwards of 30,000 participants this year. So really exciting way to celebrate our 50th anniversary with the community.
It sure is, and we hope that some of you will be joining us there. Now, Trudy, do we have any activities planned in the U.S. as well?
Yes. I mean, the birthday is actually on August 26th, 2009, so I think you'll see a lot more local activities in the U.S. market and our dealers across the country this summer.
Wonderful. Thank you, Trudy. Now, I have one final question for Jim. Jim, we just learned all about the new MINI Convertible. What are your expectations for MINI this year and in the near future? Do you mind sharing that with the audience?
No, I'd be happy to. I think you'll see that MINI will very prudently grow, but grow over time. We're filling up our model lineup, but we're by no means trying to become the largest car company on earth. We just want to build a great selection of cars for people that share our mindset. We will always hold true to our brand values. So from that perspective, that's very important, and I think you'll see that in our future product. Trudy mentioned the 50th anniversary, and we will have two special products that we'll be telling you about a little more later this year. And then looking a little further down the road, there will be a fourth MINI variant, a MINI that is a little bigger but has some special capabilities compared to prior MINIs, and that will help fill out the lineup.